Governor Branstad has laid out his plan to boost Iowa's education. It could mean big changes to how Iowa hires teachers and tests students. CRI hears reaction from Oskaloosa educators.
CRI speaks with City Council candidate Joe Caligiuri. It's the first of our candidate interviews leading up to the November election.
And CRI takes a look at a high school program that's serving up more than breakfast. These stories and more tonight on the CRI Weekly News for October 7th, 2011.
You're watching Emmy Award-winning news coverage of Oskaloosa and Mahaska County, CRI Weekly News.
Good evening and thanks for joining us. I'm Jonathan Gregg.
And I'm Matt Freeman.
State educators and legislators are mulling over Governor Branstad's newly proposed education reform plan.
The 18-page blueprint calls for several changes, including new tests for students, incentives for current teachers, and stricter requirements for prospective teachers.
The perfect storm, all things have come together at once.
Oskaloosa School Superintendent Russ Ryder says Iowa schools are on the brink of potentially huge changes.
Something like this probably hasn't been seen in Iowa since the 1970s.
On Monday, Governor Branstad and Education Director Jason Glass unveiled their plan to revamp Iowa schools. The blueprint, called One Unshakable Vision, World-Class Schools for Iowa, is designed to put the state back at the top of national education standards. According to the National Assessment of Education Programs, or NEEP, in 2009, the state of Iowa ranked 27th in the nation.
There are a number of things. There are some bold changes, there's no doubt. I think that's probably what the state has needed for some time.
The proposed changes in the governor's blueprint include setting a 3.0 grade point average for teachers seeking admission into Iowa preparation programs. Currently, there's no set GPA. Creating an incentive program for teachers who excel in the classroom. Developing new tests that align to the Iowa Common Core, something Oskaloosa schools are doing already. And requiring all third graders to pass a reading test in order to advance to fourth grade. If students don't pass, they would have to attend and successfully finish a summer reading camp in order to move on.
Sometimes you feel like you're on your heels when you hear something like that.
Dana Sarig says the proposed third grade test came as a surprise to her and the rest of the third grade teachers at Oskaloosa Elementary School. On Wednesday, they met after school to discuss what the new test could mean for their classrooms.
We don't know what type of test they will be taking, and if a student doesn't pass the test, what does that mean for them? Do they get a second time to take the test? Is this cut and dry, or are there gray areas? We just don't know. We don't have a lot of information.
Ryder says one of the biggest questions for the proposals is how would the state fund all of the changes?
The legislature's got themselves, I wouldn't say a problem, but they've got themselves a challenge because they're going to have to be able to find ways to pay for this particular program.
Branstad and Glass haven't set a price tag on the proposal. Currently, Iowa funnels 58% or around $4 billion of its yearly funding to education. State lawmakers say if many of the proposals are adopted, that figure could rise by more than $100 million to more than 60%. The state legislature will tackle education reform in January and decide what, if any, of Branstad's proposals are adopted.
The framework includes 16 different reforms. Some could go into effect as early as fall 2012. All would be fully in place by 2022. To see an extended interview with Superintendent Ryder, visit our website, www.critv.org, and click on the Education News link.
Twice a week, students at Oskaloosa High School have another choice for breakfast, a coffee drink or snack, from the Spirit Cafe. Special education students run the cafe, teaching them real-world skills and giving them a chance to connect with their peers. CRI's Amy Langdon takes us behind the scenes at the Spirit Cafe.
It's just before 8 a.m. on Tuesday morning, and a line of high schoolers is forming outside Mrs. Durandi's classroom. The kids outside are waiting for a tasty treat before first period, while inside, students are getting their job assignments. At 8, the cart of sugary snacks is wheeled out and organized chaos ensues. But the Spirit Cafe is about more than giving students a snack before school.
Kids learn how to work a job and get some job skills, and they interact with peers in the hallway.
Work doesn't start and end here, though. Prep started the day before, and the students are involved in the entire process, from shopping to cooking to selling.
We decide what we're going to make. And then we go to the store, we shop for our items, we pick up those, we go to the bank, we come back, and then we sell it.
They're learning how to navigate the store, finding items they need, or asking help for what they couldn't find.
We could say, excuse me.
Excuse me. I need to get some peanut butter.
Aisle 6.
We try our best to really get our kids out into the community, and they just become friends. They're just like everybody else.
Hey, PJ. Hey, Sandra. Hi, Leah. Hey, Harlan.
Just today, out in the hallway, I had a regular ed student turn to one of my students and offer her a quarter because she couldn't find all the money that she needed. And they had a really nice conversation. And they didn't know each other. And I thought, wow, that's really what this program's all about.
Thank you.
Back at the cafe, Alexis Mizlon would agree. Her favorite part?
Delivering drinks and seeing all of our friends.
For CRI Weekly News, I'm Amy Langdon.
All proceeds from the Spirit Cafe go to help cover costs of the special ed program, as well as supporting the Special Olympics.
William Penn University is adding campus resources that could benefit the entire community. The university is adding 2 Iowa Workforce kiosks, one in the Career Services Office on the second floor of Penn Hall and one in the Wilcox Library. Iowa Workforce closed Oskaloosa's office in August, replacing its services with computer kiosks. The Center for Independent Living and Indian Hills Community College Extension in Oskaloosa also have the computer-based resource. The William Penn Workforce kiosk will be up and running on the 13th. Anyone can use the state-funded service. Another local restaurant has closed down, but one more might be coming to the mall. Hot Stone's Steak and Pasta Grill closed recently, and the owners couldn't be reached for comment. But according to signs at the former La Pechanga location in Penn Central Mall, a new Italian restaurant is going to fill the space. Remodeling work is underway on the restaurant. A name and opening date have yet to be announced.
Your Mid-American bill will have a higher surcharge starting next year. Oskaloosa City Council members approved an increase to a franchise fee. It's a tax added to your Mid-American bill every month. It's jumping from 0.2% of your total bill to 3%. So if your Mid-American bill is $100, your franchise fee payment will go up from 20 cents to $3. The city is trying to raise enough money to make major street repairs, and council members had to put that in writing. They had to approve a revenue purpose statement, which is a list of items the money can be spent on. The last time the council met, members were considering these 3 options: spending money on public safety, equipping the fire department and police department and emergency services, building, repairing, remodeling public utilities, and building and repairing streets, bridges, sidewalks, and streetlights. On Monday, the list was down to the last 2 options. Everyone was on board except council member Aaron Versteeg.
Okay. I've been telling my people, I think we're all telling the people the same thing, it's going to be for streets only. You put a word, just remodeling, that opens up anything.
So as far as sewer underneath the street, water, now other services that are located underneath the street,
we've got funds for that.
Okay.
We collect sewage on the water bills, water runoff, we collect that.
The council approved the revenue purpose statement 6-1. You can watch the full council debate on our website, www.critv.org.
The 3% franchise fee will be adding more to your Mid-American energy bill this winter, but Mid-American is educating its customers on ways to save before temperatures drop and energy bills go up. CRI's Molly Agnes has more.
The rustling of leaves. The aroma of pumpkin spice lattes. In the midst of harvest season, Oskaloosans can sense fall is here. As pleasant as the weather is now, people know the cold is coming. Mid-American Media Relations Manager Tina Potoff says Oskaloosans can take advantage of the nice weather now to reduce energy bills when the cold hits.
The more you do to prepare your home for the winter, the more you're going to see an impact on your utility bill.
Mid-American offers a list of easy energy saving tips on their website, such as seal up drafty windows, use Energy Star light bulbs, open blinds on south-facing windows on sunny winter days, turn off kitchen and bathroom exhaust fans to limit moisture in your home. And the number one tip on the list, complete a home energy audit.
We offer 2 different types of home energy audits. The first one is online, where you can actually go through a small simulation. The other thing we offer to our customers who have homes or own homes built before December 31st of 2000 is an in-home energy audit.
In 2009, 47 Oskaloosa homeowners had an in-home energy audit. There were a few less in 2010 with 44. This year, 22 have been completed. Potthoff expects this year's in-home energy audit number to surpass the last.
People are very, very cognizant about what they're paying on everything. So we might end up seeing our numbers go up just a little bit more when it comes to energy efficiency efforts, people applying for the in-home energy audit to see if they qualify. I would anticipate that the numbers might gradually increase as we continue through October and November.
Located at 709 High Avenue East since 1910, this century-old home will be the 23rd in Oskaloosa to have an in-home energy audit.
I'm very excited about having this done. I know that I just know there's going to be many things that I just wasn't aware of.
Melody Creighton has owned the home since 2004. She says she heard of the free home energy audit program on TV and called MidAmerican immediately.
First and foremost in everybody's mind when they have one of these done is, how can I cut back on my monthly expenses? So right there, let's cut down on the utilities.
Creighton signed up with a budget billing program through MidAmerican and spends $190 on her monthly bill. MidAmerican says an in-home energy audit can lead to big savings for years to come, but savings vary, depending on factors like the size of a home and what steps are taken after the audit.
Not using as much in resources, I'll do it in a minute.
For CRI Weekly News, I'm Molly Agnes.
Creighton's home will be inspected October 18th. She doesn't know how much she'll be able to save, but says anything would help. To see if your home qualifies for an in-home energy audit, go to our website, www.critv.org, and click on the Energy Audit News link.
Four seats on the Oskaloosa City Council are up for grabs. Leading up to the November election, CRI is sitting down with the council candidates. This week, we hear from challenger Joe Caligiuri, running for an open at-large seat. The 54-year-old married father of three works in product development at InterPower Corporation and is a member of the Oskaloosa Planning and Zoning Commission, which approves, among other things, building permits. Joe Caligiuri, thank you so much for joining me.
It's a pleasure. Thank you.
You're running for city council. Why do you want to be on council?
Well, as you know, maybe 2 years ago I ran for city council, and unfortunately I didn't make it, but that was always something I always wanted to do. It's a challenge. I like working with people mostly, and also I like, believe it or not, working with regulations and things like that, because I do a lot of that where I work at. I just enjoy the job.
You're on the Planning and Zoning Committee. What do you take away? What can you take away from this experience that would help you on the council?
Well, I've learned a lot about Oskaloosa, but also in the Planning and Zoning, the regs there on, you know, the ordinances and stuff, or the ordinance for Oskaloosa. I learned a lot of that, and what I'll take away from that is, as far as the on the council, is I got a foothold, I guess you can call it, into knowing some of the ordinances. Mm-hmm. And I know some ins and outs of what's going on in council. I watch it every time they meet.
You've been following the council?
Oh yeah, I watch it at home, at the luxury of my chair.
Well, let's talk about what's been going on in the council. Lately, the council has been debating how it should use taxpayer money and whether or not it should help fund nonprofit requests. Some on the council say we should look at it on a case-by-case basis. Others think that nonprofits shouldn't even apply to get city money. Do you have any thoughts on this debate?
Kind of two ways, I guess. But I would say the taxpayers' money, mine included, I have to lean towards it's for the city, you know, it's for to the upkeep of the city, pay our in-city employees and so forth. If we have an organization that comes to council, say, can, you know, request funds, I think that should be taken under consideration. But I believe that the taxpayers' money needs to be used for this, you know, for city.
Mm-hmm. Do you think there should be a blanket statement of how to handle requests, you know, fairly?
I really don't have an answer for that. Maybe I do. I still believe that it should be used for, you know, this for the city. Mm-hmm. I think it has to be done by case by case. If we have the funds to do that, well, I might consider that.
You ran back in 2009. Roads was a big discussion point. It still is. Lately, the council has been talking about raising this franchise fee. It's a fee that people pay on their MidAmerican bill. Raising that to help build money so they could build roads, repair roads. Your thought, is this a good way to for a city to raise money as opposed to raising property taxes? Is one better than the other?
Well, one's got to give. You either raise property taxes or, you know, raise the franchise fees. I'm for it as long that the monies be used for what we say is going to be used. I've been watching that on the city council, you know, back and forth on that. And my concern is, once this all gets approved and we go forward with it, those monies need to be used for what we say it's going to be used. We don't want future councils to come in and start dipping into it for something else.
The election is in November. You take your seat in January. During the heart of budget talks, when you're forming the next fiscal year's budget, are you ready for that challenge to jump in onto the council and start delegating how the city spends money?
Oh, yes. I've done budgeting before. Maybe not at this level, but once I get in and learn what the city's has done in the past, it doesn't take me long to grab hold of what's going on. So I don't see an issue there.
There will be four candidates on the ballot, but one former council member, Jimmy Carter, announced earlier this week he is launching a write-in campaign. CRI will host a City Council Candidates Forum Wednesday, October 26th at 6:30 p.m. at Smoky Row. Candidates will answer questions from a panel and take questions from the audience. The public is encouraged to attend. Coming up after the break, we'll find out how the soybean crop is looking this harvest.
On a special episode of Oskaloosa Today, Mahaska County residents come together to commemorate the 10th anniversary of the September 11th attacks. Get an exclusive look at the tribute ceremony at the Oskaloosa Bandstand.
It's great to be an American. Always remember
that united we stand firm against our enemies.
Don't miss the next episode of Oskaloosa Today. Oskaloosa remembers, next Wednesday on MCG Channel 12. On the next One Day Getaway, I go wild. I head to the Blank Park Zoo in Des Moines.
We have like 180 species, which represents 15 to 200 animals.
Come along as I explore the zoo and see all the different animals.
I don't know, to me, this looks like a weird raccoon.
Watch One Day Getaway on MCG Channel 12.
Welcome to the new CRI website. Stay up to date on the stories that impact you. Search for exactly the info you need. CRITV.org, your new and improved online destination for news and entertainment. Get to know more about the CRI. Vote in our interactive poll. Comment on stories that grab your interest. Experience the Oskaloosa and Mahaska world digitally. Learn about the Mahaska community and find the resources to help you get involved at CRITV.org.
Oh, hey, I'm Stuart Barnaby, host of The Kids Show. Tune in and join the fun.
Wow, look at that.
Even you can be on the show. Just give me a call. You can tell a joke.
And appeal who? Knock, knock.
My joke is, what?
I got nothing.
Tune in every Tuesday and Thursday at 4 p.m. and every Saturday and Sunday at 8 a.m. on MCG Channel 12.
Welcome back. Mahaska County harvest is winding down. This year's corn crop turned out to be a good one after a rough start, but now farmers are moving on to soybeans. CRI reporter John Hoffman met up with the Boonder family picking beans in the northeast part of the county.
Yield has been tremendous this year. Things are going real well, and it's fun to combine good beans.
This onboard monitor gives Mark Boonder instant information about the crop he is harvesting.
Agriculture is getting more and more technical. We're starting to fine-tune some stuff,
like identifying trouble spots in the field to fix for next year and adjusting the combine settings for this year's harvest.
Throughout the day, you know, you got to change the settings on the combine so you get a clean sample of soybeans.
Samples and statistics from this field are showing a good quality crop with yields ranging from 40 to 70 bushels per acre.
Any time that you can get beans to yield over 70, for us it's doing very, very good.
Great numbers considering this year's growing conditions.
We had a wet June, dry July, dry August, so we were pretty worried about the beans, you know, because they would have been flowering right there during that dry time.
The hot, dry summer made it difficult for pollination, leaving fewer beans in the pod. But overall, yields are still looking good. The Boonder family planted roughly 600 acres of soybeans and are now looking at prices around $11 to $11.50 per bushel.
Compared to last year, that's up a little bit. Yeah, so at $11, you can make some money planting beans.
For CRI Weekly News, I'm John Hoffman.
Thanks, John. The Boonders say they'll be in the field for a few more weeks. The family farms around 2,500 acres, one of the largest farm operations in the county.
Mahaska Hospice has named a new Volunteer of the Year. Carolyn Dale has volunteered with Mahaska Hospice for 4 years. She's been helping out at the organization's Serenity House since it opened a year ago. She and volunteer coordinator Lisa McNulty attended a banquet in Des Moines honoring hospice volunteers from across the state. She stays busy at the Serenity House, answering phones, baking cookies, bringing food from the hospital.
We do anything that we possibly can to help the nurses and the aides in the house. The patients and the families all seem to be very appreciative, as well as the staff.
Dale used to work in the medical field and says volunteering at the Serenity House is a great way to continue doing something she loves.
A group of Oskaloosans is calling on community leaders to lend support in an effort to make Mahaska County healthier. The Blue Zone Project is picking 10 Iowa communities over the next few years that will receive grant money to promote healthy living. Brianne Fitzgerald, executive director of the Mahaska County United Way, says it will take the support of everybody to get the grant. She's asking Oskaloosa's biggest businesses for letters of support.
Basically what it takes is the community coming together, identifying what we already have that's wonderful in Oskaloosa, and then looking at where we have some areas where we can start improving the lives of the people that live in this community.
The Blue Zone Project promotes healthier and happier living through 9 key behaviors. Lisa Hotman, who sits on the Oskaloosa Blue Zone Committee, says the goals go beyond just diet and exercise.
To change people's lives, not only due to health as far as weight, but also, like I said, spiritually and just having a purpose.
To pledge your support of Mahaska's Blue Zone Project, go to www.critv.org and click on the Blue Zone Project link. Or you can text BZP to 772937. Tune into next week's show for more info on Mahaska's pursuit of health.
The 5th annual Kidtoberfest is happening this weekend inside Penn Central Mall. It's an event where kids can learn about area businesses, organizations, and clubs, and how they can get involved. CRI's A.J. Hodgman has more.
Starting at 8 a.m. Saturday morning, Penn Central Mall will be transformed into a fun fest. Kids and their parents will be able to browse 37 different booths inside the mall. There will be fun activities for kids, including an inflatable slide and bounce house, a martial arts demonstration, plus a fun interactive rodeo exhibit. Also, the Iowa State University Insect Zoo will be there showing off its collection of creepy crawlers, and the Des Moines Blank Park Zoo will have some animals on display as well.
They'll be able to see other kids from school, kids from different communities, maybe some family members. They'll get to play games and be on the inflatables and just meet people and learn about things and just have a lot of hands-on fun.
Vermeer Brainerd says 37 tables is the most Kidtoberfest has ever had in its 5-year history. Again, it's this Saturday, starting at 8 a.m., ending at 4 p.m. inside Penn Central Mall. The event is free and open to everyone. I should also mention that they will have door prizes and a grand prize drawing. The prize, an Xbox 360 with Kinect system. So it should be a fun time. Back to you guys in the studio.
Thanks, AJ. Kidtoberfest is put on by the Mahaska County Iowa State Extension Office and Mahaska County 4-H Club.
The William Penn football program continues to climb the rankings ladder with a 35-14 win over Olivet Nazarene last Saturday. But where did the Statesmen end up this week?
And WPU's pigskin program isn't the only Navy and Gold team standing in the national spotlight. With details, here CRI and OSP's Jason Madison.
William Penn handled its responsibility Saturday to remain undefeated at 6-0, but also benefited from St. Xavier's 42-31 win over St. Francis, Indiana, to jump up to the number 4 slot. St. Xavier remains the top NAIA program, while Marion, Indiana, and Carroll, Montana move up one spot. Missouri Valley enters the top five for the first time this season at number five.
While the Statesman football team handled business on the gridiron, the William Penn Bowlers were wrecking shop at the Midwest Collegiate Conference Tournament Saturday and Sunday in Wauwatosa, Wisconsin. The men's bowling program was nothing less than dominant. The event is considered the biggest in the Midwest, and William Penn defeated 10 of last year's 16 team championship qualifiers, including finalists Weber International Florida.
The Statesmen finished first out of 38 teams with a nine-game tally of 11,579 pins, 139 more than runner-up Lindenwood, Missouri. Mark Scuderi of Rochester Tech won the individual crown with a 226.2 average out of 301 bowlers. But Penn senior Nick Atkinson finished right behind him, tying for second with a 223.7 average. Also finishing in the top 20 were Cameron Foster, Brendan Brooks, and Sean Rangel. For CRI Weekly News, I'm Jason Madison.
Thanks, Jason. Now to the week's film review. CRI critics A.J. Hodgman and John Hoffman bring you their review of Crazy Stupid Love, rated PG-13 for coarse humor, sexual content, and language.
Steve Carell plays Cal in a mashup of love stories that revolve around his wife divorcing him.
In Crazy Stupid Love.
All right, AJ, here we go. The main theme is that all our characters are experiencing the crazy and stupid moments of love in relationships. Steve Carell is our lead and gives us a bit more of a straight-laced character compared to the previous roles that we've seen him in.
Well, I'll say Carell seems more straight-laced, but there are parts where he's just a little too ridiculous. And, you know, he isn't even the best part about this film. Ryan Gosling is the cool, smooth operator that helps a stranger get his groove back, but through it all, ends up changing himself for the better.
Beautiful. Credit card. Where are your wallets?
This movie is a two-hour quirky romantic comedy. There's a good balance of laughs in the serious moments with the strings. But what I really liked is that the story evolves. You just never know what the characters are going to do next, whether they're going to stay together, whether they're going to break up.
Well, I wanted them to stay apart the whole time. Cheating just doesn't fly with this guy. But what I did like was all the different love stories going on. You have the married couple, the 20-something couple, and then the middle school and high school romance. It reminded me a lot of the film Love Actually.
What do you want to do with me?
I want to show you off to my ex-wife and make her really jealous.
I think we all have our own definition of what love is, but this movie paints a pretty wild picture of it. There's some sexual tension, and of course there's some humor mixed in. I think it's a good movie for a date night.
No.
And I rate it worth the price of admission.
Well, at least one of us enjoyed it. Too much crazy and stupid, not enough love, not worth the price of admission.
Well, that's our show for the week.
Be sure to tune in to replays of this show airing tonight at 9 and every Saturday and Sunday at noon 6 and 9 p.m. on MCG Channel 12. And remember, you can watch all of CRI's original programming, including this show, online at CRITV.org. Also, stay up to date on Mahaska County news by following us on Facebook and Twitter.
I wanted to add one more thing before we go. This is Matt's last show. You're leaving us for Colorado.
That's right. I got another job offer in Colorado. I just wanted to say how much I enjoyed working with you and the entire staff here at CRI. I hope the viewers enjoyed it half as much as I did working here.
Well, we certainly appreciated all of your hard work.
Thank you.
From all of us at the Communication Research Institute of William Penn University, thank you for watching. I'm Jonathan Gray.
And I'm Matt Freeman.
Take care.